That's what you're going to have to get used to. They're like the babies.
Thank you. Yeah. Paul was certainly one of those examples in the scripture. I want to read a couple verses to you out of Philippians chapter 3 from the Apostle Paul. Philippians 3, verse 13 and 14, Paul said this. He said, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Paul was resolved to do that, and we need to be resolved to do that each and every day of our lives. 607 is the next song we're going to sing. What a day that will be, number 607.
Christ.
of our offering. We'll do it as we've been doing the last few weeks. Bring up your offering, present it to the Lord by placing the offering plate here this morning as an act of worship and obedience and of our love for our Heavenly Father. So we're going to have a word of prayer, and then we'll take up our offering. So let's all bow before the Lord. Father God, we count it an honor and privilege not only to be here, but to be able to worship you here today in your very presence in your house, Lord. We thank you for the many blessings, the grace, the mercy, the love, the forgiveness you give to us. We thank you for how you provide for us, take care of us, strengthen us, guide us, and direct us. And Father, we thank you that we can be obedient to your will and just give back just a small portion of what you've given to us. And so as we take up an offering, Lord, we ask that you would bless it, that you would give us the wisdom to use this offering as a way to further your kingdom, to bring honor and glory to you, and to be a witness to those who don't know Jesus. And so, Lord, bless this offering. Bless those who are giving here this morning. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. When we take up the offerings the last several weeks, Scandal Scott plays a song there, and just about the time we wrap up the offering is about the time for the chorus to hit, you know, and I'm just like, hey, let's just keep singing the song, you know, so don't be surprised if we just keep singing one day. My wife and Matt will be down, you'll just have to endure me just leave, you know, but anyway, we'll see about that.
We will see about that.
Take your Bibles, if you would, please, and turn to Matthew chapter number 11. That's where we're going to be here this morning, is in Matthew chapter 11. A couple announcements to share with everybody as you're finding the 11th chapter of Matthew. A few weeks back, we sent out a youth questionnaire for anybody who is interested in volunteering some time with the young people of our church in any way, shape, or form. We sent that out, and for everyone who filled out that survey, that questionnaire that we sent out, we do need to get together soon and have a meeting and kind of talk some things over. So if you fill that out, expect me to get a hold of you sometime this week, and we'll figure out a time where we can all get together and just kind of talk about some plans moving forward, the vision that we have moving forward with the young people of our church. And certainly God has blessed us tremendously. Just look around at the young people that God has blessed us with. And so if you did fill out that questionnaire, I'll get a hold of you this week somehow, some way. I'll get a hold of you, and we'll figure out when we can all get together sometime this week. Also, I wanted to share this. I shared this with everyone last Wednesday night at our Bible study, but I wanted to share it with you this morning here as well. Just a reminder of how good our God is, how he continues to bless and provide as he promises he will. At the beginning of this year, the leadership team and myself talked about some of the bigger projects that we wanted to do for the church this year. And we talked about a few things, had a few things in mind. And this was at the beginning of the year, and then March hit, and everything kind of went crazy. and we had to, you know, shut down for a while, and none of us knew exactly what things were going to look forward look like going forward, especially financially. And oh, me of little faith, I was very concerned with the finances of the church, with the way things were. But listen, God is so good. God continues to move and work even in the midst of 2020. So God has been moving, and God has also been laying upon the hearts of his people, of our church family, to be generous and to give, and we have been being obedient to his will. And so as the months have gone by, the finances, we're doing pretty good. And so with all that said, we are able to move forward with some of the bigger projects that we talked about earlier in the year that I was a little concerned we wouldn't be able to do. So one of the big things we talked about in January was getting a new roof on the church building itself. And again, it's a big job, a big expense, but God has been so good and he has blessed, and we are able to move forward with that. So myself and the trustees, we got some quotes and we decided on which one to go with. And long story short, they're going to start on a new roof tomorrow morning for our church building. And so we're going to roof the building, the little side parts of it, and also the shed. And it'll be the same color as the house next door, and it's going to be a great improvement on our facilities here. And so I wanted to share that with everybody just to just remind us just how God, how good he is to us, how he provides for us, and that continues to work even through difficult times as we're in this year. He's just so good. And so I don't know how long it'll take, but if you drive by and things are a mess, you know what's going on. And just give God praise for it, because he truly is so good. So with that in mind, I wanted to start us out this morning with a little participation from everybody here. I want you, keeping that in mind of how good God is, how he continues to bless and how he continues to provide, in one word or a short phrase, I want you to share that, and you can just yell it out. Don't be afraid. You're not being rude. Just yell it out. In one word or a short phrase, I want us to share here this morning as we're getting started. Share how God has blessed you in your life. Just one blessing. How he has blessed you in your lifetime. Just one word, one small phrase. Just yell it out. Don't be shy. We're all family here. Anybody at all?
Grandson.
Praise God. We don't have any grandchildren yet, but we know the big milestones in our life, that's coming. And so we look forward to that. And I've heard from grandparents that grandchildren are a blessing. Praise God for that. Anybody else?
Good health.
My wife and I were talking about this last night. We're all able to be here this morning, to get up to be here this morning. Not everybody's able to do that. And so you may be moving slow, you may have some aches and pains, but you are healthy enough to be here this morning. Praise God for that. Good health.
A roof over our heads.
Rain this morning. I came over this morning and was kind of getting everything set up, ready for this morning. And when I came over, it wasn't raining. When I went back over to the house next door, it was pouring down the rain. And I stood there under the little, you know, waiting for it to slow down. It never slowed down, so I just had to go for it. But we don't have to worry about the rain, the cold. We've got roofs over our heads. God is good. God is good.
Family.
Your family may not be perfect, but it's family. And thank God for family. Thank God for family.
Church family
as well. Our church family may not be perfect, but we're family. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. Praise him for that.
Jesus.
Praise God the Father that he loved us so much that he sent his son Jesus to die on a cross so that we could be forgiven of all the mistakes and bad choices we've made. God calls that sin. And praise him that he loves each and every one of us enough to send Jesus to die for us so that we can be saved. Any others in your life?
He gives us everything we need.
Pardon me?
He's given me everything I need.
He does that for all of us. He promises in Scripture to give us everything we need. And I've said this a million times, you hear me say it a million more, not necessarily everything we want, because there's a big difference between wants and needs, but God provides everything we need. And praise Him for that. Any others in your life? Scott?
Oh, I know Matt said a church family, but I think the fact that we belong to a good church is a blessing too.
I think our church is pretty good. I do. I look around. I look at us here this morning. I praise God for our church family. I see Him continuing to work and bless. If we weren't doing something okay, He wouldn't be doing that. And so we're just being obedient and following to the best that we can. And He blesses that. And so, yeah, we've got a good church family. Yes, sir. Any others?
Great job.
Protection. Y'all made it here safe. Y'all drove in. Well, we walked over, but we made it safe too. Got here safely. If you make it home this afternoon after we're done, or wherever you're going, and you get there safely, praise God and give thanks that He protected you along the way. And it's not just as we're traveling. He protects. He does. He's good. Somebody, I heard somebody else say,
A job.
That's something we a lot of times we will complain about, but if you got a job, praise God for that, that you have a job. It may not be your dream job, may not be what you dreamt of when you were growing up or whatever, but listen, if you've got a job, give thanks to the Lord, not only that you have a job, but you are healthy enough to hold down a job. Praise Him. He's good. He's good.
Parents.
Young people, remember that. Be thankful for your parents. Even when you're upset with them, even when you're mad at them, even if you've gotten into trouble, give thanks for your parents. And I'll flip that around. Parents, give thanks for your children and your grandchildren, your nieces and your nephews, great-grandchildren if you got them. I don't know. Give thanks for the young people in your life.
God made us souls.
What's that?
God made our souls.
God made our souls.
He did. He created us. We are beautifully and wonderfully made, each and every one of us. Scripture tells us that. And so every single one of you, God created you, who you are, how you are, and He looks at you and He says, I made you in a beautiful and wonderful way. You're very special, each and every one of you. So special, He sent His Son Jesus to die for it. That's how much He means to Him. Praise Him for that. Sharing one word or short phrase, not just how God has blessed you in your life, share how God has blessed you this last week. Just this last week. Think of a blessing just this last week. Just yell it out there.
In fellowship yesterday.
I'll mention this briefly in the sermon. There was a group of us that went paintballing yesterday. And just out there having a great time shooting one another with paintball. We're all sore and welted up this morning, but man, everybody that went walked in with big old smiles on their face, like, oh, I can't move my arm and this hurts so bad, but man, just a big old grin. We had a great time of fellowship yesterday. And I was talking to somebody else this morning, and you know, even with that, God the Father looks down at His children. And even when we're doing something as crazy as paintballing, whenever God's children are doing something in unity and are getting along, God the Father looks at His children and He's pleased with that. And so, yeah, that was a blessing for this week. I had a great time. Hurt all over, but I had a great time. Has God blessed you this week? God is through it. He saw us through. Any others? Just this week.
A big garden and a lot of work.
What's that?
Big garden and a lot of work.
A big garden, but you reap the benefits of that hard work, and that's biblical too. Hard work is biblical. God did it. First hard worker in a garden was who? Adam, all the way back to the beginning. So praise God for that. Any other blessings from just this last week?
The
that y'all get back to school. It's a little different than it was when you left. Some difficulties you're facing going back, but that you can get back to school, see your friends, all that stuff. Yeah, it's a blessing. Any other?
Blessing to parents, too, that they're back to
school. Well, yeah, I'll let you say it. Yes, yes. Any others? That's it. That he got us through the week and for Jesus on the cross. Thank you, Carter, for that one. But listen, I wanted us to start out with all of that, just to remind us of how good God is, how he takes care of us, how he blesses us and provides for us in our lifetimes, and then even throughout the week, if we take the time to stop and count those blessings. They're there, no matter what kind of week you're having. And the same God who sent all those blessings in your life, the ones we mentioned, and there are many others that weren't mentioned, the same God who sent those blessings in your life, the same God who sent those blessings last week to you, the same God who sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross, the same God who is good and holy and just and almighty, will he not continue to bless in the future? He will. Will he not continue to provide your every need in the future? He will. Will he not continue to strengthen you and see you through whatever you're going through? He will. And will he not continue to save the souls of those who call upon the name of his Son, Jesus Christ? He will do that. Almighty God will continue to do that, which leads us to our verse today, to the words of his Son, Jesus, here in Matthew chapter number 11. We're going to look at one verse this morning in Matthew chapter 11, and that's verse number 28. Look at that verse with me if you would, please. Matthew chapter 11, and verse number 28. Let's read that together. Matthew 11, 28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let's bow before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the many blessings that were mentioned here today. Father, we thank you for just how good you are to us. You're better to us than we deserve. We thank you for that. While we were yet sinners, Lord, your Son Jesus Christ died on the cross for us. We thank you and praise you for that. Lord, as we look at your Son's words here this morning, I pray that you would speak to us, your Holy Spirit would work in the lives of each person here, in the lives of each family, in the life of our church family. I pray that we would have ears to hear what you would have us to do, your will in our lives. I pray that we would not only hear it, but Father, we would be obedient to it as well. We would respond to your will in our lives here today. Give me the words to speak here, Lord, and bless each one. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So here in Matthew chapter number 11, at this point in Jesus' earthly ministry, if you would go back and read, you have seen that he has traveled to many different cities in the region there, Jerusalem and around, many different cities. He's done many mighty works, performed many miracles at this point here. He has sent his disciples out two by two, and they as well did many great things. Jesus has done all that at this point. Yet he has been rejected by many as well. And if you go back and read through chapter 11, you'll see that Jesus rebukes these cities that he has been through. He rebukes them for their lack of repentance and their lack of belief. He speaks again, as he has before, of salvation, and we see that in verses 25, 26, and 27, he's speaking of salvation. And if we would jump forward to verse 28, we see there he again is going to throw out this invitation. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. This verse speaks of salvation, of how the lost can be saved. It speaks of how the sinner becomes a saint. It talks about how blinded eyes can receive sight through faith in Jesus Christ. Because of, as we've mentioned, what was done on the cross. As he was taken from the cross and put in the tomb, and then 3 days later rose again and is alive today, sitting at the right hand of the Father. We see that this verse speaks of that, of salvation. And then verses 29 and 30 talks about the sanctification of the believer, how we take upon ourselves the yoke of Jesus, how we follow him and live his lifestyle, how we begin to become Christ-like. But verse 28 is what we're really going to focus on this morning. And it has to do with salvation. But verse 28 is not just about being saved. It is not just an invitation for unbelievers, which it certainly is that. But it's not just an invitation for unbelievers. Verse 28 holds great value for those who are saved as well. This verse holds great value for those of us who know Jesus. Contrary to what some think and really what some teach, your troubles do not end simply because you know Jesus. Your troubles do not end simply because you are born again. Simply because you are saved. Listen, the truth of the matter is, you may be saved. You may be born again. You may have called upon the name of the Lord and put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior. I mean, you remember the day, you remember the time, you remember where you were at. You could share your story. You could share your testimony. But the bottom line is this. All that is true, but troubles will remain. Jesus tells us that himself. Troubles will remain. Trials will still come in your life. You'll still go through tough times. Even the most faithful follower of Jesus. I mentioned Paul before. A little bit ago. He's a great example of that. You're still going to go through tough times. You're still going to face tribulations, temptations, setbacks, and heartaches, even when you are following Jesus Christ. And that's why there is so much peace and power for us in verse number 28. Look at it again. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. From the oldest follower of Jesus here this morning to the very youngest, no matter what you've been through or what you're facing right now, regardless of your circumstances or your situation, whether it be tough times at home, at school, at work, whatever it may be, the words of Jesus here in verse number 28 apply to you as well. Those who are saved, the words apply to you. His promise is for you. He offers this guarantee to each one of us. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. If life has got you down, if the past has got you down, if this year, 2020, with all that we have been through, has got you down, consider these words of Jesus here in verse number 28 as we look at it together this morning. I want you to concentrate on the very first part of the verse, where Jesus says this, "Come unto me. Come unto me." Those first three words of the verse, "Come unto me." Those words right there, they require some action on your part. They require some action on your part. When Jesus says, "Come unto me." Back when I was in school, my good buddy Gabe, which you've heard some stories about him before, he's visited a few times as well. But back when I was in school, I would go over to his house, and they had a big old house. And we go, we hang out in his room and stuff. But to get up to the stairs that led to his room, we'd have to go through the living room there. It was a big, big room. And his dad had his favorite chair, you know, that he set in the living room there. And we'd walk through there, and his dad would be sitting back there. And his dad was a big guy. And he had one of those deep, you know, loud, deep voices. And we'd be going through there, you know, goofing off as we did. And every once in a while, as we're going through, his dad would say, "Son, get over here." And I'd be like, "Oh, my gosh, he's in so much trouble." You know, just because of the tone and how, "Son, come over here." And I'd be like, "Oh, man." So I would just sneak off, you know. I would just keep going. And my friend Gabe, you know, he would go and talk to his dad. And I'd run up to his room there, wondering what he did wrong, wondering what he got caught doing, or whatever it was, you know. And so a few minutes later, Gabe would show up in his room, and I'd be laughing. I'd be like, "Oh, man, what'd you do now? What happened?" And he's like, "What are you talking about?" I'm like, "Well, your dad called you over, you know. He said, son, you know, you don't say son unless you're getting in trouble, right?" And he's like, "No, that's just what dad does. Yeah, he just calls me over from time to time." And as I was thinking about that and thinking about this verse, you know, when we were walking through that living room and his dad said, "Son, come over here," what did my buddy have to do? He had to go over there. He had to take some steps and get over there. If he had just kept walking up to his room, well, he would have been in trouble then. But when his dad said, "Son, come over here," that required some action on his part. The Savior is saying to each one of us, "Come unto me." That takes some action on our part. When is the last time that you went? When is the last time you moved as the Savior says, "Come unto me"? When's the last time you put forth the effort? Because it takes some action on our part. It takes some work. When is the last time that you intentionally set aside some time and went to the Savior? You know, we do all kinds of other things. We fill our day, we fill our schedules with all kinds of things. And I got to go here, I got to go here, I got to go over there, I got to do this, 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 and this, and this. When is the last time you intentionally set aside some time and simply went to the Savior? I'm talking more than a prayer before a meal. I'm talking more than a 10-minute Devo in the morning. I'm talking about more than listening to some Christian radio on your drive into work. I'm talking about some quality time with Jesus that you put forth the effort to make happen. Because he's waiting. He says to us, "Come unto me." We see examples in the Scripture of those who would pray all night long. Jesus did that himself. We see examples of that. In our discipleship groups, we have learned how to spend an extended amount of time with God. Not just to spend some time in prayer, but to spend an extended amount of time. A whole day, a couple days, if that. We've learned how to do that through our discipleship groups. Because that time with Jesus is so necessary. And Jesus is waiting. The Savior is waiting. He says, "Come unto me. Spend some time with me. Stop spending so much time with your problems. Stop spending so much time with your worries and your concerns and all those things. But spend some time with me." John chapter 6, verse 35. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Jesus says in verse number 28, come unto me. How often do you do that? How often do you do that? And I'll throw another question out there. Who can do that? Well, Jesus answers that next question in the verse. Let's look at it again. Verse number 28, where he says, come unto me. Well, who can do that? Second part of the verse tells us, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. All who are weary and tired, who labor and are heavy laden. Listen, that is an invitation from the Savior himself. To come unto him, who everyone that labors and is heavy laden, who is weary and tired. That's just not for churchy people. That's not just for someone else. And sometimes we fall into that trap. Well, somebody else, that's for somebody else. They could have a relationship with Jesus, but not me. It's not just for someone else. It's not just for that other family that you see. Well, my family could never go to Jesus. My family could never follow Jesus. It's not just for someone else or some other family. When Jesus says all, he means all. When he says all who labor and are heavy laden, he means everyone. Jesus means anyone. Anyone here this morning. And I tell you, so many times we can fall into that trap of believing, that lie from the enemy himself, where, not me. I couldn't do that. He's not talking about me. Not with the things I've been through. Not with the mistakes I have made or the things I have done in my life. Listen, it's somebody else, but it could never be me. Jesus couldn't be talking to me. You don't know. Pastor, you don't know my past. Well, maybe I don't, but he does. And he still loves you. And he still sent his son Jesus to die for you. And he says, when he says all, he means all. Come unto me, all you who labor, the verse says. All you who labor. All you who are doing your best, and you're just tired. You ever get that way? I mean, you're doing your absolute best, and you're just tired. You're labored. All who labor, you're working hard to make it. And you're just weary. All you who labor, you give it your all, and you're just worn out. You're doing all you can, but you're tired. You're tired physically, you're tired emotionally, you're tired spiritually. You've labored. And listen, you've not just labored, but you are heavy laden. Jesus says that all ye that labor and are heavy laden. You're heavy laden with burdens. The burdens of life that we all face. You're heavy laden with burdens, with baggage, with bills and the blues. You're heavy laden with so many things, and we allow so many things to weigh us down, don't we? Heavy laden. It's all too much. Listen, it's all too much for you. It's too heavy for you to carry on your own. You're sick and tired of being sick and tired. It's all weighing you down. You're tired and you're weary. For anyone feeling that way, anyone, Jesus says, come unto me. Come unto me. Not just somebody else. He's talking to each one who feels that way. Come unto me. Psalm 105, verse 4. Seek the Lord in his strength. Seek his face forevermore. Seek the Lord. It takes some effort. Get up and go to him. Requires some action. He's waiting for you. All who will come unto him. All who will do that. And what will he do for all who do that? What will he do for those who come unto him? What will he do for those who are tired and are weary? Last part of the verse gives us the answer. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. And what will be the result? I will give you rest. I will give you rest. How nice is it at the end of a long day, no matter what you've been through in the day, at the end of a long day, when you get home and you sit down in your favorite chair or wherever your favorite spot is at the end of the night, how nice is it that you can just sit back and relax and rest? You know, rest is a good thing. Rest is a good thing. We get so busy sometimes that we, I think, feel that rest is a bad thing, but rest is an important thing. Scott mentioned the paintball yesterday. And for those who went, we did have a good time. We had a great group. 15 of us there. And we went out there and we just had a blast. It was like 3 hours of just nonstop running and ducking behind things and getting shot up and everything. It was a lot of fun. But I'll tell you what. When we were done, we went back. We had a little lunch together there. Did that. And then when we got home, and I talked to several, went home and we were nasty. We were filthy. We were dirty and muddy and covered in paintball. We stunk and everything else. But I'll tell you, when we got home, we were wore out, tired. But to get a shower and then just to sit down and rest, man, it felt good. It felt wonderful. Feels good to rest. It feels good to rest. With all the stuff we go through in life, it feels good to rest. What better place to find rest than in the arms of the Savior? What better place to find peace than with the Prince of Peace? What better place to relax than right next to Jesus? Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 25. For I have satisfied the weary soul, and I have replenished every sorrowful soul. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. How good is God? Jesus, he is our shelter in the time of storm. Jesus is our ark in the time of the flood. Jesus is the rock when all around us is sinking sand. And when Jesus cries out to all, to everyone, every single person, when he cries out to all who are weary and tired, who labor and are heavy laden, and he says, come unto me and I will give you rest. He says to you, you don't have to carry all that weight around on your own anymore. When he says to you, come over here, let me help you out a bit. When he says to you, I love you, I died for you, and I'm living for you, waiting for you to come to me, and let me give you rest and peace and for you to follow me. He says, I will give you that peace and I will give you that rest. And that's an invitation to who? To all. To all. For those who don't know him or who are not saved, it is an invitation for salvation. For those of us who are saved, who are born again believers, it is an invitation to come and spend some time with our Savior when this old world weighs heavy on us. It's an invitation to all. I titled the sermon this morning, if you noticed in the bulletin, Rest Area Ahead. If you've ever taken a long trip or you're driving down the highway, sometimes you get weary doing that. Long drives, putting up with all the other people on the road. And sometimes you get tired and you just need a break, and you'll see that sign where it says Rest Area Ahead. You're like, oh my goodness, I can pull over. I can make it. I can rest a little bit. I can stop and go to the restroom. I can go to the overpriced vending machines and get me some really bad snacks and all that stuff, you know? I can do all that, but I get to rest a little bit. And there's that sign, rest area ahead. But you know what? What do you have to do in order to get there? You have to veer off the highway, don't you? You got to turn that steering wheel a little bit. You got to slow that vehicle down, and you got to come to a stop there at the rest area. You got to do that. I think too many times in life, we pass right on by that rest area, which is the Savior. But we just keep on driving, weary and worn out and tired. Jesus is waiting. He'll give you rest. Will you go to him today? Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Every head bowed, every eye closed.